Many of us fall in love with physics long before we truly understand it. Which is unsurprising, given physics is our lens to the entire universe. From the geometry and warping of space-time and the structure of causality, the quiet order of laminar flow and clean bending of streamlines around obstacles, to the shifting shimmer of colors on soap films due to the interference of light, it all feels magical yet intuitive and draws us in. But there's a catch. Cloaked beneath every elegant physical phenomenon are heavy equations and rigorous mathematics, which can truly feel overwhelming at times. For many, the wonder slowly slips away and is replaced by fear, and someday, they give up. But it is not this day. This day, we fight and take on math by the reins, because only when we speak the language of math can we fully appreciate the beauty of physics. We start with unlocking the power of trigonometry. And don't worry, at Eigen Akademie, we build every idea from the ground up, one clear concept at a time. In our physics series so far, we've already encountered trigonometry in action when resolving vectors, working with solid angles, and so on. But for the younger audience, here's a quick refresher. We have this right angle triangle, and you can see how the sine, cosine, and tangent are defined in terms of the various sides, something I assume you already know. But there's one thing. Most of us grew up thinking of trigonometry as a triangle thing. In physics, though, you'll see that it has more to do with circles, so it's time to shift our perspective from triangles to circles. To aid that shift, let's look at a unit circle. So there's our circle, and on the right you can see the graphs of sine, cos, and tan theta, which I assume you're familiar with. Let's observe a point on the rim, initially lying on the positive x-axis at 1, 0, as it rotates counterclockwise around the circle. At every instant, we also drop the vertical and horizontal projections of the point onto the x and y axis respectively in green and blue. From what you know about triangles, you can see that these are sine theta and cos theta respectively. And there on the right, those projections are plotted as a function of theta, which in this case is the arc swept by the circle. The green curve traces sine theta, the blue one cos theta. A dashed guide keeps their theta values aligned with the circle. The purple curve shows tan theta, which is equal to sine theta over cos theta, and it shoots outwards towards plus or minus infinity whenever cos theta tends to zero, explaining the vertical breaks near pi by 2, 3 pi by 2, and so on. One full revolution of the dot produces one full period of each graph up to 2 pi, revealing how simple circular motion encodes the wave-like behavior that reappears throughout physics. Now let's actually go into the more advanced trigonometric identities, which will be useful throughout our study of physics here, starting with trigonometric sums of angles. You might have encountered them already, but instead of rote memorization, let's see how we can draw out some of the results visually, once again using a unit circle, in a manner that is intuitive. Take this quarter of a unit circle. It will be sufficient to work on this. We'll use a tool we are already familiar with, that is vectors. Consider vector v1 at an angle alpha, counterclockwise from the x-axis. Given the radius and angle, you can resolve this vector and find the coordinates of its tip as cos alpha, sine alpha. Now, say we rotate v1 by an additional angle beta and obtain a new vector v2. Its coordinates are cos alpha plus beta and sine alpha plus beta. Now, how do we express that in terms of alpha and beta separately? We need to make a few constructions for that. First, Let's drop this perpendicular from V2's head to the y-axis, forming a right-angled triangle with the hypotenuse being the radius of the circle, which is 1. Now, the vertical piece is sine alpha plus beta, while the horizontal one is cos alpha plus beta. So in a sense, these are the two trigonometric sums we wish to find the expressions for. Let's see if these can be related to any other lengths. Let's project V2 onto V1. The length of this projection opposite to the angle beta is sine beta, while the side of this triangle adjacent to beta along V1 up to the point of projection from V2 is cos beta. Now from the point of projection, if we draw a perpendicular onto the x-axis, we obtain another triangle with angle alpha, and given the hypotenuse is cos beta, something we just obtained, the length of this projection turns out to be sine alpha times cos beta, while the side adjacent to the angle alpha is cos alpha times cos beta. Now for our final piece of construction, let's extend the perpendicular projections in white and blue on the x and y axis respectively so that they meet. You can see that from the dashed red lines here. And we end up with another right angle triangle. If you look carefully, you see that this triangle is similar to the previous one with angle alpha. Again, we already have the value of the hypotenuse as sine beta, so we can obtain the other two sides. The opposite is sine alpha sine beta, while the adjacent is cos alpha sine beta. I shall now remove all the other lengths and labels so you can focus on the length of the sides of this triangle we have formed without all the clutter. So from the vertical length, the left side reads sine alpha plus beta, while on the right side we have the fragments sine alpha cos beta in white and cos alpha sine beta in red. As for the horizontal length, which from the bottom of the rectangle we see is cos alpha cos beta, this is equal to the sum of the segments cos alpha plus beta and sine alpha sine beta. So we have expressed sine alpha plus beta and cos alpha plus beta in terms of the individual sines and cosines of angles alpha and beta. In a similar fashion, if instead of rotating the vector by beta counterclockwise, you'd have rotated by minus beta, or rather clockwise by an angle beta, you could obtain the difference of angles. You can also test the same out by putting in negative beta into these two equations, and so finally, we can write the four sum and difference identities in compact form as the follows. You may already have encountered and perhaps used these while solving problems like we did in the previous video on three bugs, but now you know how these results actually arise. In the future, you'll see that this gives rise to the concept of the rotation matrix given by R of an angle, where R of beta can be written in terms of sine and cos beta as written over here. This 2x2 rotation matrix is ubiquitous in many areas of physics, from quantum mechanics and information to rotational motion, relativity and more. We will not go too deep into this right now though, as the concept of matrices remain unexplored in our series so far. But in case you are familiar with the same, you can go ahead and see how we can express V2 in terms of V1 with the aid of R beta, or take it a step further and try to derive R beta as a fun exercise. Okay, so let's finish our table of trigonometric sum and difference identities. We can also obtain tan of alpha plus minus beta from our current equations. We'll write it as sine over cos, then expand it. Divide the numerator and denominator by cos alpha cos beta, and there you have it. It's tan of alpha plus minus tan of beta over 1 minus plus tan of alpha times tan beta. We can also go a step further now and obtain identities for double angles. Say we have alpha equals beta equals theta, and insert theta into the summation identities, and you get sine of 2 theta equals 2 sine theta cos theta, then cos 2 theta equals cos squared theta minus sine squared theta. You can also express this one in terms of only cos or sine of theta using the identity cos squared theta plus sine squared theta equals 1. and you'll see how this comes in handy in an instant once we move on to half-angle identities. Anyways, lastly, you also have tan 2 theta equals 2 tan theta over 1 minus tan squared theta. So far, so good. Time to take a look at half angles now. Take a look at cos 2 theta from earlier, and instead of 2 theta, let's consider it to be just cos theta. So on the right hand side, the terms are in terms of theta by 2. Now from the third equation on the right, we can express sine theta by 2 in terms of the square root of 1 minus cos theta over 2. Similarly, from the second equation, we obtain cos theta over 2 in terms of the square root of 1 plus cos theta over 2. And from these two results, we obtain tan of theta by 2 as plus minus square root of 1 minus cos theta over 1 plus cos theta. I'd suggest you to work these out explicitly with a pen and paper in case you haven't been able to get it. All the equations you need are on this screen, just club them around. In physics, half angles are frequently used to simplify calculations related to wave mechanics and oscillations, and even further on in your undergrad courses like signal processing, AC circuit analysis, and so on. Right, so next, once again, let's look at the sum and difference identities. Let's split them up from their compact form so you have four equations to work with. We are going to use them to convert trigonometric products to sums. We label each of the equations and now we club pairs of them together and either add or subtract and then divide by 2. For instance, if we add the equations 1 and 2 and average them out, we eliminate the cos alpha sine beta term and can express sine alpha cos beta in terms of sine alpha plus beta and sine alpha minus beta. In a similar fashion, you can chalk out three more equations. These product to sum relations are what let you separate time and space parts of standing waves, analyze sum and difference frequencies in nonlinear optics, break signals apart in Fourier analysis, and so on. One more toolkit you'll see everywhere, converting sums to products. It's cleaner than it sounds, and again we'll do this systematically, not by memorizing of course, but by substitution and simplification. So, we start with the sum and difference identities once again. And let's take A as alpha plus beta over 2 and B as alpha minus beta over 2. That implies alpha equals A plus B and beta equals A minus B. Now, consider sine alpha plus sine beta. You can rewrite this as sine A plus B plus sine A minus B. All that is left to do is to expand using the sum and difference identities and simplify, which finally should give you 2 sine A cos B. And thus, putting in the values of A and B in terms of alpha and beta, we get sine alpha plus sine beta equals 2 sine alpha plus beta by 2 times cos alpha minus beta by 2. In a similar manner, you can obtain the sum to product identities for sine alpha minus sine beta, cos alpha plus cos beta, cos alpha minus cos beta. These identities are extremely useful in physics, from power reduction in integrals, to solving trigonometric equations, modulation and beat analysis in waves and signals, and so on. You'll see all of this in physics once we expand on the same here on this channel. For today, let's conclude here, and in the next video, we'll continue with our mathematical essentials for physics with approximations, where we'll look into small angle and binomial approximations. So if this was useful, do subscribe to Eigen Akademie, hit the bell to get notifications, and stay tuned for more educational content. See you in the next video.